Before we get started, let's take a second to appreciate the shutter sound. Today we're going to be talking about the Fujifilm X-T2, this camera right here, in the year 2020. The X-T4 is out currently, and the X-T3 is a previous model. I really don't want to speak about too much of the specs, but just a little bit of information from this. So, this camera was released back in July 2016, so that means that this is solely approaching 4 years of this camera being out, and the asking price for it, when the X-T2 was released, they wanted about $1,600 for it for the body only. So I mean, 2020, you can find these pretty fairly cheap. So what I did, I bought one off of eBay for about $600, so it was just the body. I really didn't look at the market, but I always wanted a Fujifilm camera. So, and then I went on Craigslist and I was able to find one for $800, but this $800 one came with a battery grip, about 4 batteries. It also came with the 35 millimeter f/2 lens, and about 2 or 3 battery chargers. So the thing is, you can find pretty good deals on this, and I don't want people to just necessarily think that since this is an older camera, it's not really that good, and the reason why I purchased it. So what I usually have, I have a Canon EOS R as my main camera, which I'm currently shooting on, and I have a 50 millimeter 1.2. So I mean, I have a couple of lenses, and the thing is, I like going around taking pictures. I wanted to have a backup camera just in case. Since I always wanted a Fujifilm camera, I just went to that finally. Paid $600 for the body, so you really can't beat that. So if I were to drop it, I mean, I'd be hurt, but I wouldn't feel too bad if I were to drop my EOS R with the 50 millimeter 1.2 lens on. So those are some things to consider. But besides all of that, let's talk about the good things about the Fujifilm. And as a note, most of these images here are not altered. These are straight out of body, and more of these can be found on my Instagram page at rez1k_. This camera, number one, I don't think that many people really talk about Fujifilms. You hear a lot of people talking about Canon, you hear a lot of people talking about Nikon, you even hear a lot of talk about Sony, but you do not hear about this. One thing is, this is an APS-C camera, which means that it's going to be smaller, the sensor size, so it's going to be a crop sensor camera compared to the EOS R, which is a full frame 35 millimeter equivalent. So what that means, you're not going to go ahead and get like all that bokeh that people are looking for in images. And that's kind of a preference thing. I mean, where I'm at right now, that's not necessarily I'm gonna say what I'm looking for. So, but looking at this camera, it's real simplistic. You have the dials, just like right up here, where you have your ISO at the top right here, and then you have your shutter speed right over here, and then you have your aperture, which is gonna be on the lens. I mean, so it may sound like it'd be a little bit difficult at first, but one thing you can do, they have an L switch, or a T button or a T switch on these cameras where you can put it to, and you can customize the dials so you can change it on the fly, so it's a lot quicker than stopping and looking and making adjustments on it. So X-T2 is pretty cool for that. And then another reason why I like it a lot is because they have the film simulations on it. I do shoot in RAW a lot, but the thing is, a lot of those pictures that I take, I necessarily don't edit them all. So the thing is, what I want to have is something where I can look at it and say, hey, you know, I think I like this one, and I probably don't have to do too much editing to it. So the cool thing about it is, when you go inside the Fuji camera, you have Provia, which is like ideal for a wide range of subjects. I think that's more like the basic color for Fujis. And then you have the Velvia, which is more a vibrant reproduction ideal for landscape and nature. And then you have the Astia, I think I'm saying it right, more of a subdued look. And then the next thing that you have is my favorite, which is the classic chrome. So pretty much as soon as I picked up this camera, that's what I went to. Then you have the pro negative, which is for ideal for portraits. Then you have the pro negative, which is for portraits as well, with soft gradations and skin tone. Then you have Acros, which is black and white, but the cool thing about it is you have the different filters. So I mean, I'm not sure if you're too familiar with it, but on film cameras, you'll buy these different type of color filters. And when you have black and whites, I mean, if you have a yellow green or a green filter or a red filter or even an orange filter, it'll change the way that the blacks and the grays and the whites look, or the different tones, I should say, in your film production. So they got that actually built into the menus on here, which is pretty cool. And then they have a monochrome, of course, which is just black and white. And then they have a sepia, so it's just different tones. They also have a grain where you can add if you want a light or heavy in it, which is pretty cool to give it a grain type of look. Most of the time when I'm out using this, I'm shooting this in JPG, surprisingly. So, I mean, it does have dual card slot, which is pretty cool because my EOS R doesn't even have that. So what I do, I have a 128 in my first slot, and then I have a 64 or 32 gigabyte in my second one. And what I do, I just have it where it puts the raw images in the 128 gigabyte, and then it puts all the JPGs in the smaller compressed one. So another thing is Fujifilm uses something called a X-Trans sensor, or I believe. So pretty much their files are a little bit different compared to Canon files, which are CR3s, or Sony's, which use the ARWs and things like that. So when it comes to processing, it's a lot different. So I know people say that they really don't like messing with Fujifilm file types in Lightroom. So what I do typically, I just move the JPGs, which are already compressed, and then they have more of the ideal look that I like, and I add those into Lightroom. And then if I want to go forth and do something a little bit more serious, I'll go ahead and take those Fuji files, or the X-Trans, or I can't remember what they're called. I'll take those and I'll put those into Capture One, which is the better software for Fujifilm. And one more thing. Fujifilm cameras have this thing built into it where you can go ahead and you can select different aspects of like what you like of the picture, or let me rephrase that. So they have this thing where you can adjust the highlight tones. So this is all in body, so you don't have to really worry about doing all this. You have to do it in post a little bit still, but you don't have to do it as much. So if I'm out shooting, I can make sure I get the tones right, the shadows and all that stuff in the camera, so I don't have to do too much work post-processing and just go forth and run and gun it pretty much. So I think of this as something like a tool that makes my process a little bit easier, be more effective and more efficient compared to something where I have larger files and I have to do a lot of editing to get the photos to look what I wanted to look like. So I mean, don't get me wrong, the Canon EOS R is a great camera, but the Fujifilm is just a lot more fun to bring with you. You do everything on the inside of the body. All you have to do is transfer it, make a couple adjustments, and if you're just posting on social media, you really don't have to do a lot of like pixel peeping and stuff like that, as if you're going to do a print or if you're going to make a large image. So this X-T2 in the year 2020 is actually a good camera. So I mean, it's a pretty good bargain. $800 for all that, that's a pretty good deal. So if you're looking for a camera right now, don't let the whole, you know, this is the new camera with, you know, this can shoot 8K, and I mean, this is future proof, but the thing is with the 8K camera, we don't even have pretty much TVs to watch 8K in, so we barely have 4K. In my opinion, I mean, I like shooting at 1080p. So, I mean, even though this is being shot in 4K, but most everything that I do is shot in 1080p still. One more thing, another important thing or interesting thing that I like about the Fujifilm cameras are the screens. So the EOS R has the articulating screen, which folds out and rotates and stuff like that, which is cool. But the screen right here, I mean, people may or may not like it, but just a basic flip out right here. So I mean, if you're going for a low angle shot, and then if you want to go for one where it's above you, just tilt it like that. Another cool thing is you can go ahead and you can press this side button right here. And what that does, it allows you to flip the screen sideways. So if you were to be, well, I guess if you're trying to get a portrait oriented photo, you just can put it like this, have it lower, so you still have that angle to look at it. So you don't have to try to put yourself in a weird position or be on the floor. So that's cool stuff. All right. Now the bad regarding the Fujifilm. So number one, the autofocus points. When you're selecting a focus, you only have, you're real limited. So when you're trying to select a point, you have a lot of gaps of places where you can't focus. I'm not saying it's like something you can't work with, I mean, but you will have to change your composition a little bit or change your focus point. If you're doing portraits, it does have facial recognition, so it does know where the face is at and things like that, which is good. So that's not a bad thing at all. That's really it. I really can't see too many negatives about this camera. I mean, even though it came out in 2016, I'm slowly thinking that this is probably going to become my favorite camera. I guess one more thing I can probably say is the fact that it's an APS-C camera, so it's not full frame, but I mean, there's nothing wrong with that. So I mean, it's still a good camera. But now I'll go ahead and I took some pictures with some examples. So I'll give you a little bit behind the scenes of me walking in different areas of Atlanta. Thank you for tuning in, and please feel free to subscribe to this YouTube channel to see future videos, and feel free to subscribe to my Instagram page at REZ 1K_. Thank you for tuning in. Until next time.